In 2014, there was one Silicon Valley startup that was widely applauded for its ambition to revolutionize a massive, high-stakes industry that was as old and antiquated as the Middle Ages. In an era where tech startups and venture capitalists were criticized for thinking small, not solving real problems, and constantly bringing Instagram clones, Airbnb copies, and other petty mobile apps to the market, this company was considered a breath of fresh air and celebrated for its risk-taking. The media portrayed this startup as a rare embodiment of the type of big problems that Silicon Valley should be solving and that all other startups should aspire to their level. That company was called Opendoor, and their idea was to make it possible to buy or sell a home in just a few clicks. Opendoor was heralded as the next big startup behind Uber and Airbnb, given the scope of the problem they were going after, the size of the real estate industry, and the company's proposed value creation. Opendoor was the perfect mix of all the hottest Silicon Valley trends from the 2010s. Online to offline businesses, data science, machine learning, algorithms, artificial intelligence, and automation all applied to the old-fashioned world of real estate. In Silicon Valley, where academia is greatly devalued, Opendoor's differentiation was that by recruiting the best Stanford PhDs, data scientists, mathematicians, software engineers, and quants, they could build proprietary algorithms that could accurately price the exact current market value of any given home and then predict the resale value of that same home over time. With these proprietary algorithms that could price in every single aspect about a home and its neighborhood, Opendoor's value proposition was that they could value homes with more precision, rigor, speed, and accuracy than a traditional real estate agent. The company could then use these algorithms to buy homes at scale, quantify their value, repair and renovate them with as little capital as possible, and then resell that home at a higher price within 3 to 4 months, basically flipping homes at scale with algorithms and automation. Through the years, Opendoor was treated as Silicon Valley elite. It was a startup that was so bold, so disruptive, that it was considered untouchable. Opendoor was not flipping homes. Instead, in their own words, they were a, quote, once-in-a-lifetime market maker that could transform the American residential real estate industry. In its early years, Opendoor and its founders collected award after award, they teased publicly the progress and scale of their technology, and they raised massive amounts of funding from every reputable investor in Silicon Valley. Since the company's numbers and technology were selectively shown under NDA to only a trusted few behind closed doors, there was no way for the public or the greater industry to know whether or not Opendoor's business model was even viable or the company's true business performance. As a result, Opendoor was able to quickly build up hype in its private years, and entrenched industry giants like Zillow and Redfin began to worry that they were missing out on something big. This ushered in the instant buying phenomenon, or iBuying for short, where Zillow, Redfin, and Opendoor burnt hundreds of millions of dollars every year, flipping thousands of homes across the country based on algorithms. Fast forward several years to 2020, where iBuying has revealed itself to be a short-lived fad. Zillow, the company with the biggest market share, presence, and pockets, terminated its iBuying business in a high-profile failure, laying off thousands of employees after losing over $500 million. Opendoor settled for an IPO via SPAC at $6 billion valuation, yet the company today is a shell of its former self. Even during the low interest rates of the pandemic and the hot real estate market of the past 4+ years, Opendoor has never once lived up to its billing as a market maker, with a current stock price of less than $5 a share and a public valuation below $3 billion, lower than its valuation 4 years ago in 2019. In this episode, we'll explore Opendoor, the iBuying business model, its business performance, and the long-running misconception that computers, machine learning, and algorithms make better decisions than humans. Let's start with the problem. Opendoor's goal is to be an online marketplace that pulls in people looking to sell their homes and people looking to buy homes. Because Zillow and Redfin already dominate real estate as the main informational and networking platforms that connect buyers, sellers, and agents online to handle transactions offline, Opendoor needed to go further by bringing the entire transaction online to create and capture sufficient value for itself. But in order to entice home buyers and home sellers to transact online on Opendoor, the company needed to offer homeowners a significantly better experience on their platform. A home by design is the most significant financial transaction that most Americans make. Buying a home enables the accumulation of wealth through stable appreciation and leverage, the reduction of tax liability, and an increase in net worth, whereas selling a home nets a sizable payout. Because of how much is at stake when it comes to buying or selling a home, the real estate industry has always thrived in these offline, manual, face-to-face, high-touch, relationship-based, one-to-one engagements that are guided by agents. Selling a home on average takes about 3 months, and it can be a stressful, time-consuming, and complex experience. To ease the process, roughly 90% of sellers in America use a real estate agent. A real estate agent relies on their experience, the home's condition, local sales comparables, to come up with the listing price. And this is all subjective, so each agent will have their own take on how much a home can sell for and may suggest that owners make these simple repairs or make major upgrades to increase their sale price. Homeowners generally look for a credible local agent with a proven track record, but this is similar to finding a good doctor, which is a hit or miss. A good agent knows the market, prices the home competitively so it reaches its highest value, maximize the returns for the seller, they set up the right staging to attract buyers during open houses, and they close quickly. A bad agent will overestimate or underestimate the market, they'll suggest unnecessary repairs or renovations that end up costing the sellers more money than it adds, they'll negotiate poor terms, or they'll price the home so low that they leave money on the table, or too high that the listing languishes and becomes unattractive. 75% of homeowners only ever consider one agent when they're selling their home, which can make all the difference in returns. Homeowners spend on average $6,200 on cleaning, storage, repairs, renovations, and staging to prepare their home for a sale. When a buyer makes an offer on a home, they generally conduct an inspection to uncover hidden problems that can result in additional demands or further negotiation, both of which can cut into the seller's return and prolong the deal cycle. Once the offer is accepted and the terms are agreed to and the contract is signed, it can take another 35 days on average to close. The seller has to wait for the buyer to coordinate their agent, their mortgage broker, the escrow, and their bank. Roughly 20% of offers end up falling through due to the buyer being unable to secure financing or getting cold feet. When this happens, sellers have to relist their home on the market, they have to wait for a new buyer and offer to come in, and then go through this entire 3-month ordeal all over again. Most sellers are also buyers themselves, but they can't afford to buy a new house before selling their current one. This means that when sellers submit purchase offers for homes that they want to move to, but they have contingencies that they have to sell their current home first, it can put these sellers at a disadvantage when they're competing with other buyers who are bidding for the same house. While a good agent lightens this overhead, the reality is that these complexities and timelines under a traditional real estate buy and sell transaction are fundamentally unavoidable. Opendoor's bet was to reinvent this experience online by eliminating the open market along with all the third parties involved, like the buyers, the banks, the brokers, and the agents. Sellers could avoid all the stress and complexity by selling their home directly to Opendoor. Any homeowner can go to Opendoor's website, put in their address, answer questions about their home, and immediately receive a preliminary cash offer. After an in-person assessment to verify the home's condition, Opendoor then presents a final all-cash offer to purchase the home. With Opendoor, the homeowner also gets the freedom to choose their date of closing so that they can sell the home, move out, and buy a new home all on their own schedule. Opendoor's business model centers around this value proposition of convenience and liquidity for sellers. The company takes a flat 5% service fee, which is subtracted from the all-cash offer, and it's a cut that the company argues is cheaper than using a traditional real estate agent. Agents typically charge a 5 to 6% commission, which doesn't include the repair, renovation, storage, move-out, and staging costs if one was to list their home under the traditional open market. Depending on the home's condition, Opendoor also charges another percentage for repairs and renovations. When you sell your home to Opendoor, the company takes ownership immediately as the buyer, and you as the seller get to walk away with cash in hand without ever having to repair, touch up, or even clean your home. This streamlining in exchange for convenience and liquidity is fundamentally the same as those places where you trade in your old phones, cars, and electronics for cash. The twist is that Opendoor is doing this at scale with a lot of homes, a lot of money, and algorithms. When sellers go to Opendoor's website to get an estimate of how much the company would pay for their home, these numbers are automatically generated by algorithms. When the company conducts its home assessment, that data is collected into the underlying pricing algorithms, which then generate the final cash offer. There are also other algorithms that identify the repair and renovation opportunities for that specific home that would generate the most returns on paper. When the repairs and renovations are complete, Opendoor lists that home again back on the open market at a higher price with the goal of flipping that property within 3 to 4 months, and that resale price is also set by an algorithm. Opendoor's differentiation lies in its proprietary algorithms and data science. With each free home assessment, even if the owner ultimately chooses not to sell to Opendoor, the company says that it's collecting data on the home and its surroundings. Then through its machine learning and artificial intelligence, Opendoor claims that it's able to process these inputs to drive accurate home prices that dynamically adjust in real time with all these other algorithms that can forecast local demand, detect risks, identify outliers, and predict future housing inventory in the exact area. Since its founding, Opendoor has claimed that its algorithms are more rigorous and accurate than the tedious, static, small sample size, napkin math, weighted average pricing that traditional real estate agents do to come up with home prices. While agents only look at a few comparables and some big ticket items like the bathrooms, bedrooms, square footage, and lot size, Opendoor boasts that its algorithms can quantify hundreds of variables in any given home, like floor types, stainless steel appliances, pool sizes, granite countertops, even to surrounding factors like the proximity to transit and schools, and even abstract variables like road noise. Opendoor also claims that their algorithms adjust for appreciation, so local sales and regional trends are all continuously priced into a home's value and updated, so they occur when they happen, whereas an agent's valuation becomes outdated quickly as a one-time fixed calculation. And these algorithms with machine learning and artificial intelligence keep improving with more data and iterations, whereas an agent's approach rarely ever changes. Opendoor's business is all about economies of scale. The cost it takes their algorithms to price one home is the same as pricing 5 homes or 1,000 homes. The company argues that its economies of scale apply all the way through when they resell that same home later for a profit. Operationally, Opendoor reuses local contractors and they buy materials in bulk so that when it does repairs and renovations, it's cheaper and faster with volume discounts. But like everything in life, there's a catch when you sell to Opendoor. When you sell to Opendoor, you're giving up on your upside and returns. In exchange for this convenience, flexibility, and instant cash, Opendoor's offers are generally priced below market value. Opendoor's all-cash offers generally come in at 0.2 to 2% lower than a home's fair market value. When you add on Opendoor's 5% service fee, that means then sellers are generally leaving at least 5 to 7% of their home's fair market value on the table. Ultimately, Opendoor has to buy homes below their fair market value in order to be able to resell them later within 3 to 4 months for a profit. This is a huge contrast to the traditional open market approach, where agents typically list properties at or above market value in order to get as much money as possible. Opendoor's instant liquidity and convenience really appeals to only a subset of homeowners. The average length of home ownership in America is 8 years, and states like California and cities like Austin have been red-hot sellers markets for a really long time. Most people, when they're selling their home, are looking to get as much money as possible, and they find that the traditional approach and the hassles and headaches that come with that are a small price to pay for maximizing their appreciation. When we wave away all the flashy tech buzzwords and data science and machine learning and artificial intelligence, we can actually see how Opendoor's business is fundamentally a lot more niche than the company would like to admit. The lack of mainstream appeal is reflected in the real seller conversion, which is one of Opendoor's key operational metrics. Real seller conversion is the percentage of homeowners who accepted the below market cash offer from Opendoor and sold their home to the company out of all the homeowners that got a free estimate on the company's website. Real seller conversion for Opendoor has hovered at 35% for the past 3 years, meaning that roughly 4 out of every 10 engaged sellers who get an offer choose to continue to sell to Opendoor. The company operates only in 44 markets today, so that 35% real seller conversion is significantly lower when you put it in the perspective of the entire nationwide market. From a qualitative standpoint, the success stories that Opendoor highlights seem to reinforce how niche the company's appeal really is. In one recent example, a family relocated from Syracuse to a small Arizona suburb during the pandemic. This unhappy family urgently wanted to move to Phoenix, but they couldn't afford to do so. So they used Opendoor, where the family was happy to take a loss in their home value in exchange for the cash and flexibility. In a single year, this family had sold 2 homes and moved to 2 new places, which is really unorthodox, especially when you consider that there are significant tax penalties incurred for selling a home before 2 years of ownership. These tax penalties are how the American government discourages flipping and incentivizes long-term ownership at the individual level. The other success stories that Opendoor shares are also similar. One family spent an entire year RVing across the country for fun before deciding to sell their home. Since the parents worked remotely and their children were homeschooled, they didn't want to go through the disruption of listing on the open market and having strangers come in their home for open houses. They sold their home to Opendoor for less than fair market value in exchange for convenience, but their lifestyle suggests that they were already financially comfortable and didn't need to maximize the sale of their home. Other families were inexperienced, nervous first-time sellers who deemed it was worth giving up 5%+ of their home's fair market value to avoid the stress of the open market. The other catch if you dig deep enough into Opendoor's financials is that you'll find flipping homes in itself is actually not where the company's margins come from. Quote, "Our business model is designed to generate margins from our service charge to sellers and not from the spread between acquisition price and resale price." So while Opendoor charges a flat 5% service fee to sellers, the reality is that the total cut that Opendoor takes at the end is actually higher than that 5%. After the in-person assessment, that offer price will typically get lower as Opendoor identifies problems in the home that need to be repaired. Depending on the scope and severity, Opendoor's repair fee ranges from 0.5% to another 5%. Whether or not these repairs are needed or if the percentage taken is fair are not things that sellers can negotiate with Opendoor. By charging an additional percentage of home value for repairs, rather than simply crediting the cost of repairs, which is what would happen in a traditional transaction, Opendoor gets to pay even less of the home's fair market value and pocket those savings to increase its own profit margin. So while the company gives initial cash offers that are close to a home's fair market value, a seller still walks away with roughly 5 to 10% less after the service fee and non-negotiable fees, like the repairs, are tacked on. And Opendoor now has a home in its inventory that they've bought for 5 to 10% below market value, which then increases its profits and lowers its risk when it flips that same home back onto the open market. It's worth noting that under the repair case, after Opendoor acquires the home, the company actually has no obligation to actually do the repairs or even provide proof that it's completed the repairs. In one recent example, Opendoor deducted an additional $20,000 from a seller saying that this cost was needed to replace the HVAC, replace the flooring, and repair the foundation. The company ended up relisting the home on the open market in 10 days with just a fresh coat of paint and without any of these major repairs that it charged for. In this example, that $20,000 became Opendoor's additional profit, and this is pricing power in action. Opendoor's strategy is that even if its business overall is pretty niche, the sellers that it does attract and the sellers that it does appeal to are in these life situations where they have no choice but to eat these heavy, non-negotiable premiums to achieve the cash, convenience, and speed that they want. Opendoor is like a house of cards that's only as stable as the housing market. It's a risky, capital-intensive business where if your algorithms are wrong, then your valuations are wrong and the whole business goes belly up. When you're buying homes based on algorithms, you're amassing this huge multi-million dollar inventory of vacant homes across many states with non-trivial carrying costs. If you do get your valuations right, the housing and economy could shift in the wrong directions for factors that are mostly beyond your control. Your algorithms also have to be able to forecast future demand and the highest realistic value that each home can get on the open market after repairs within 3 to 4 months, and then hope to actually sell it at that predicted price to successfully complete the flip. Opendoor, for better or worse, is a modern example of Silicon Valley's incestuous system between its VCs, its founders, and its startups. To pull off such a business, a ton of capital is required not just to buy the homes, but also to build the technology. Only a handful of people in the world can fundraise $320 million for the idea to flip homes at scale using algorithms in the name of disruption, machine learning, and artificial intelligence. Opendoor was hatched by Keith Raboy, a Silicon Valley icon best known as a member of the PayPal Mafia, an early executive at LinkedIn, and the COO of Square before a sex scandal forced him out. Keith put together an all-star team of angel investors made up of his friends, who were also tech royalty like the CEO of Y Combinator and the founders of PayPal, Affirm, Yelp, YouTube, Reddit, Box, and Lyft. The collective star power of this angel investment team brought immediate credibility for the idea and company by association. Opendoor got to work in 2014 with a $10 million Series A, buying up $200,000 homes in Phoenix as a testing ground for its algorithms. By 2016, Opendoor stated that it was responsible for 2% of all home purchases in Phoenix. Opendoor continued to raise funding at then-historic levels with very little scrutiny, public criticism, or skepticism. More and more VCs joined in, with an $80 million Series C led by NEA and Khosla Ventures, a $210 million Series D, a $325 million Series E from Andreessen Horowitz and from the second largest home construction company in the United States, and eventually $400 million from SoftBank. But what was more important than the money was the institutional reputation and the connections of these venture capitalists. Backed by such a large roster of reputable equity institutions, Their collective credibility made it easier for Opendoor to raise billions more dollars through debt. Opendoor burns money at an astronomical level higher than any typical tech startup. There's a significant upfront R&D cost needed to build and maintain and tune these algorithms. There's equally high operational costs in having contractors who inspect the homes, repair and renovate them after acquisition, along with local boots on the ground operations team who help manage the inventory, validate trends, and verify the algorithm results in person. Finally, there's also high sales, marketing, and administrative overhead needed to successfully flip these homes within 3 to 4 months in advertising them online and manually engaging interested buyers, even if all the numbers are automated by the algorithms. The cash that Opendoor raises from its equity sales is only ever enough to fund the company's operations, but not enough to fund also buying homes in cash. Opendoor's business model is all about scale. If it doesn't flip enough homes, it'll never be able to offset its operational overhead. Opendoor leans on debt from traditional lenders to fund its home purchases, and this part is a fascinating exercise in corporate finance. The way that debt financing works is that Opendoor has a set of non-recourse senior debt facilities and mezzanine debt facilities, all of which they are backed by the homes that it purchases. So Opendoor can borrow 80 to 90% of the cost of a home from its senior debt facilities. As soon as Opendoor sells a home, the company is required to repay what it has borrowed immediately back to these senior debt facilities. If the home is sold at a loss, then Opendoor has to come up with the cash elsewhere to pay off what was borrowed. If Opendoor is unable to pay off what was borrowed, then that home will be foreclosed. These senior debt facilities charge a variable interest rate based on LIBOR and other global benchmarks, which these days is only getting higher. Under its senior debt facilities, Opendoor can borrow a total of $7.8 billion. The company can also borrow an additional $3 billion through its mezzanine debt facilities, which will fund 100% of the cost basis for any given home. But this generosity comes at a price. The interest rate for borrowing any money from its mezzanine debt facilities is a flat 10%. Through 2019 to 2021, Opendoor has purchased more homes, and so its outstanding debt balance has ballooned from $271 million to $6.1 billion. Based on their most recent year-end balance, if the interest rate goes up a single percent, Opendoor needs to find cash to pay $40 million more in interest expense. One can quickly extrapolate just how much financial 3D chess is needed to keep the company alive on a day-to-day basis. Opendoor makes these big $100,000 bets with its algorithms regularly. They burn cash daily to keep the lights on, and that's just because of how much labor is required in flipping homes, and they have to hope that they hit a certain scale where they've resold enough homes to be profitable and maintain enough cash on hand to pay off the debt and interest whenever a home is sold, and they need to hope that the homes in its nationwide inventory don't tank in value before they're flipped, and they have to keep their equity valuable in order to keep their funds going. Opendoor is truly a modern-day house of cards. The company's revenue grew from $1.8 billion in 2018 to over $8 billion in 2021. To grow, they scaled, going from 18 markets to 44 markets in the US in those 4 years. The company went from flipping 7,000 homes a year back in 2018 to now flipping 21,000 homes most recently in 2021. It could be Opendoor's growing confidence in its algorithms or investor pressure to keep up equity value in a market downturn, or potentially both, as the company's inventory and deal sizes have grown significantly. In 2019, Opendoor had 5,500 homes in their inventory worth a total value of $1.3 billion, with an average home value around $233,000. By 2021, the company had tripled that number in 17,000 homes in its inventory, worth a total of $6 billion and an average home value of $358,000. Opendoor is clearly now targeting higher value homes and markets to generate profits after proving accuracy on lower value properties. Opendoor's gross margins aren't high, but like we said, they don't have to be when you're taking a percentage of a $300,000 transaction. Despite a flat 5% service fee, the company's gross margin has increased year over year from 6% to 9%. This reinforces that shift in Opendoor's monetization strategy that we covered earlier. In order to improve their top of funnel and to pull more sellers through the door, Opendoor likely had to lower their service fee to 5%. It used to be as high as 12%. Once these sellers get hooked on the cash offer, Opendoor then takes a bigger cut through its repair fees. But even repair fees have a same limit, and so it's safer for the company to spread additional fees and disguise its additional margins through various ancillary services like the title, escrow, and mortgage, and not just repair alone. Despite Opendoor's top-line growth, the company has incurred loss after loss after loss, each bigger than the last. Even in a strong rebound year in 2021, where the company sold a record number of homes, Opendoor incurred a record loss of over $600 million. But what's most worrying is that while revenue grew by 3.5 times from 2020 to 2021, its operating expenses also increased by 3.2 times to achieve those numbers, indicating that there's a much more linear business here than what one would expect from a tech company. The one metric that Opendoor constantly champions to its investors is contribution profit after interest. And contribution profit after interest takes the final home sale price minus the purchase price, the direct repair cost, holding costs, selling costs, and the interest that's repaid to those senior debt facilities. Total contribution profit after interest of all the homes sold in a single year grew from $27 million in 2019 to $482 million in 2021. If we divide this metric by the number of homes sold every year, then we find the unit economics. In 2019, Opendoor made $5,800 gross profit for every home that was sold. For every home that was sold in 2021, Opendoor made slightly over $22,000. If we take Opendoor's total operating expenses in 2021, we add up their advertising, marketing, sales, engineering, legal, and administrative costs and salaries, we get $1.3 billion. How many homes does Opendoor have to flip at its current unit economics of $22,000 of gross profit for every home sold to offset these operating expenses? The answer is that Opendoor would need to sell roughly 60,000 homes a year just to break even with how much it costs the company to exist in its current burn rate. Every time the interest rate goes up a single point, Opendoor needs to sell an additional 2,000 homes in order to offset that additional $40 million in interest expense. Opendoor's leaders love to pound their chest about how amazing their contribution profit after interest is to investors, but the rub here is that no one's questioning whether there's money to be made in flipping homes. People have been flipping homes all over the world for decades. People still flip homes today. What people are questioning with Opendoor and all these other iBuying companies is that whether or not there's enough money to justify trying to do it at scale with these algorithms, technology, and automation. The hype that Opendoor generated during its private years ended up attracting competitors and copycats who all wanted a slice of the next big thing in real estate. Zillow jumped headfirst into the iBuying trend with the launch of Zillow offers in 2018, proudly predicting that the business could achieve a run rate of $20 billion by 2024. Redfin followed shortly after with its own home flipping business called Redfin Now. Zillow had actually invented computer home valuation 15 years ago with Zestimate, and the company believed that while they weren't the first mover, they still had the advantage and expertise since they were the pioneers of these algorithms in the first place. For 3 years, Zillow spent hundreds of millions of dollars in pure cash buying up homes in Phoenix and Dallas based on its algorithms before things crashed during the pandemic. The housing market initially froze during the lockdown, then exploded as interest rates were lowered and the economy resumed, but then since have cooled down. Zillow's algorithm mistakenly continued to assume that the market was still hot and overestimated prices, leaving it with a sprawling inventory of homes that they had grossly overpaid for but could only sell at significantly increasing losses. In a single quarter in 2021, Zillow had lost more than $400 million. The CEO shut down Zillow offers and terminated its entire home flipping business division, made a public apology, and laid off 25% of the company's workforce, leaving over 6,000 people without jobs in a looming recession. To the glee of Keith Raboy, Opendoor, and the Silicon Valley elite, the demise of Zillow offers was validation that these algorithms, machine learnings, and artificial intelligence, the technology was the moat, and Opendoor's technology was best in class, and the quality of technology can be a competitive advantage in itself. In the case of Zillow offers, it seems like the folks there just turned on the computer and blindly followed whatever it told them to do. In the case of Opendoor, they do invest in having local field teams with boots on the ground to regularly validate their algorithms and buy decisions to ensure accuracy before committing the cash. But while this proves that Opendoor's algorithms are objectively better than Zillow's algorithms, it still doesn't validate if the business model even works at scale. In the words of Zillow's CEO, the entire instant buying business, quote, looks far more like a leveraged housing trader than a market maker. What's interesting is that when you look at OfferPad, who is an exact copycat of Opendoor and its biggest remaining direct competitor, their financials are eerily similar. It's really eerie how identical Opendoor and OfferPad are when you look at their materials, their wording, their content, their value proposition, their pitches, and their presentations. The only difference is in branding. One of them is blue and one of them is orange. While Offerpad also flips homes at scale using its algorithms, the company takes an intentionally slow and picky approach. Offerpad only buys homes that it has confidence that it can flip in, and the company really optimizes for profitability over growth and volume. When we compare Opendoor and Offerpad unit economics by lining up their contribution profit after interest side by side, both of them are identical at roughly $22,000 per home sold. While Offerpad sells significantly fewer homes than Opendoor year over year, Offerpad has tightly controlled its cost to achieve a net profit of $6 million in 2021 for a measly 0.31% net profit margin. While it's encouraging that at least one iBuying company is profitable, it still fails to answer whether or not this entire business model is lucrative enough to justify its own existence. So the next time that someone talks up on how a company is making an industry or the world a better place with artificial intelligence, machine learning, and algorithms, tell them the story of Opendoor and Zillow offers. We're many, many years away from that reality. But to the Silicon Valley elite, the venture capitalists, and the founders who all feed off of each other writing these buzzwords to huge salaries, high valuations, and IPOs, admitting these things out loud would be sabotaging their own pump and dump, get rich quick schemes.